Blackstone presents The Only Life That Mattered, The Short and Merry Lives of Anne Bonny, Mary Read, and Calico Jack Rackham by James L. Nelson. This book is read by Kate Redding. To Lisa Marie Nelson, the pirate who first told me about Anne and Mary, and then plundered my heart. Prologue. The bells rang out from the whitewashed towers of St. Jago de la Vega on Jamaica's north shore. Their deep bass tone filled the narrow cobbled streets, the cool stucco homes, glanced off the red-tiled roofs of the government buildings, so like those of old Spain on which they were modelled. Pealing, pealing. Today the court sits in session. Today is a trial of pirates. Today will be tales of the sweet trade, of murders and crimes most notorious, villainy on the high seas. The ringing found its way into Mary Read's cell, where she sat on the stone bench, an outcropping of the cell wall, really, and traced with her eyes the lines of dark mould that snaked along the mortared crevices between whitewashed bricks. A pretty sound, she thought. She'd been hearing the bells for 5 minutes, but she was just now listening. Pretty. For a death knell. A shaft of morning light came in through the single window, divided into 5 equal parts by the iron bars. The light looked like a solid thing as it passed through the ubiquitous dust, as if Mary could reach out and break off a piece and hold it in her hands. At least it is warm, she thought. Warm and dry. There were times enough in her life when she would have gladly traded freedom for a prison cell, if it meant being warm and dry. In fact, she mused, that was just what she had done, and she still reckoned she had ended up with the best of the bargain. She shifted uncomfortably, looked up at the arched ceiling. It was stone, whitewashed like the rest of the cell, like all the buildings of those Spanish colonial towns. Now that the British were the masters of Jamaica, it was a wonder to Mary that they did not paint everything brown, or some such dreary tone, as the British were wont to do. But no, the West Indies would not allow that. It affected people, it got inside them, and before the English could remake the West Indies into a drab replica of London, the West Indies had remade them in her own bright image. Mary had seen it happen time and again to Englishmen on Nassau and Jamaica and Bermuda. It had happened to her, and that was why she loved the West Indies so. She stood up at last, paced the few steps forward and then back again. Her body still ached from countless bruises, some overlapping one another, purple and ugly. Her skin was hard and tight, where a dozen lacerations were just now healing. She paused, stretched, idly scratched herself, realized what she was doing and stopped, thinking, I have been too long in the company of men. She was wearing a dress of sorts, no more than a crude homespun wool sack with sleeves. It hung like a monk's robe and itched intolerably, and caught in the sharp places of her half-healed wounds. It was difficult to get any relief from the scratching fabric and the vermin that were starting to plague her. Mary Read was no stranger to itchy clothes and vermin, but familiarity in this instance did not bring comfort. The cell, her home for the past few weeks, was not a closed room with 4 solid walls and a single impenetrable door. Rather, the front of it was all bars, floor to ceiling and side to side, an entire wall of bars. It made Mary feel like a circus animal, there on display for the amusement of others, and she hated that. Anne's cell was directly across the narrow stone alleyway that ran down the length of the cell block. They had unimpeded communication across that 5 feet of space, and that alone kept Mary from going mad. Confinement was something new to her, and it did not sit well. She paced again to the front of the cell, thrust her hands through the bars, rested her forearms on a crosspiece, laced her fingers together. She arched her back, flexed her legs, groaned slightly as she worked out the kinks that came with sleeping on a bed of matted straw. Not bloody 17 anymore, she thought. Mary looked across the alley into Anne's cell.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.